So hello and welcome to the presentation on unit number 1, single degree of freedom systems, free vibration. So up till now we have seen the contents like it is specified in this particular slide. So in this presentation we are going to see how we can formulate the differential equation of motion using Newton's law or a D'Alembert principle and the energy method. So first we will see that why we have to formulate the differential equation of motion. So actually we are forming this differential equation of motion to find out the natural frequency of the system. Now what is natural frequency of the system? So and on which particular things it depends. So natural frequency of the system depends on the geometrical parameters and the mass property of the system. And it is independent of the forces acting on the body. So why it is important to find out the natural frequency of any system? Because if we know the natural frequency of the system, we can avoid the resonance. Now what is exactly resonance is? So when the frequency of external excitation force is equal to the natural frequency of the system, it starts vibrating with large amplitude. Okay, and this state of the system is called resonance and it leads to the failure of the system. Hence, to avoid this, we should know the natural frequency of the system. So here we will use the D'Alembert principle to find out the natural frequency of the system. So what exactly is the D'Alembert principle? So it states that the resultant of all the forces acting on a body along with the inertia force is equal to zero. It is also called as an equilibrium method. According to this, a body which is not in static equilibrium due to the acceleration can be brought to static equilibrium by introducing inertia force. So let us understand this with the help of a spring mass system. So here you can see that suppose there is one spring attached to the floor or the top or the roof surface like this, and if I attach certain mass to this particular spring, so definitely this spring will get deflated by some amount. So I am indicating this as delta. So if I have to draw the free body diagram of this particular mass, means what are the different forces acting on this mass at this moment? So again I will draw this block here and I will specify one downward force which is nothing but mass and the gravitational acceleration, its product. So you will get the weight which is going to act downward, and opposite force, that is spring force, which will be stored into this, because as there is a tension in the spring, so spring tension will be like this. So forces in the spring due to tension will be like this. And opposite of that reaction will be on the mass. So it is in the opposite direction of that action. So action on the spring is a tension one. Okay. And the force on the mass will be in the opposite direction of this. So that is nothing but equal to K into delta, where K is the stiffness of the spring and delta is the deflection of the spring. So it means you will find that there is two forces are there, and because of these two forces, this particular mass will be in equilibrium. So I can write that product of mg will be is equal to k into delta. Now for the same system, if I again displace it by some amount by giving some external excitation, so if I displace it by amount x and then if I leave this, so definitely it will start oscillating about its mean position, because this is its mean position, this one, and I am displacing it by distance x here. So the moment I displace it in the direction, downward direction, by x, so total deflection of the spring will be x plus delta. And now if I have to draw the free body diagram of this particular mass again, so I have already this downward force mg which was acting on this. Okay, now when I pulled it down by x, so now the total deflection of the spring is x plus delta. So I can write one force, that is spring force, which is in the upward direction as we have seen here. So it is k into in bracket x plus delta. And as you are giving the motion to this, so it will be having some inertia force. That inertia force is given by mass into acceleration. Now indicating here x double dot by acceleration. So the inertia force which is acting upward here is given by mass into acceleration. So x double dot is acceleration. So we can write here the inertia force is equal to m into x double dot, which is acting upward in this case. So here you will find out that there are two upward forces and one downward force. So if you have to make the equilibrium of this, then you are going to add these forces according to their directions. So let us see what are the other different forces are there. So next is the spring force. I will write here spring force, that is K into bracket x plus delta, which is also upward, and the gravitational force mg, that is downward. Now according to the D'Alembert principle, let us write the equation that sum of inertia force plus external force will be equal to zero. So I am specifying the inertia force, that is m into x double dot, the inertia force and the forces externally acting over this particular mass. So that is this gravitational force and the spring force. I am writing here k into bracket x plus delta minus mg, because minus because it is downward and these two forces are positive, therefore it is plus here upward, and here it is minus because it is downward. Okay, so this is equal to zero. As we are saying, as per the D'Alembert principle, the sum of this inertia force plus external force will be equal to zero, and therefore the system will be in equilibrium. Now we'll just make the simplification of this. So after this term, I will write ms double dot plus k into x plus k into delta minus mg equal to zero. Okay. Now we have seen previously that when you have this particular equation here, that mg equal to k into delta. So here this mg and k into delta, that is equal. So this will get cancelled out from here. So remaining term is m into x double dot plus k into x equal to zero. And now therefore, if we remember the equation of simple harmonic motion, so we have to convert this equation into the form of simple harmonic motion. So what is the equation of SHM? It is x double dot plus omega n square into x equal to zero. So I am writing this equation here, mx double dot plus kx equal to zero, in the form of SHM equation. So for that I have to remove this constant from here, that is m. So I will just divide this term by m. So it will be k by m in the denominator, it will come into x equal to zero. And now if I compare these two equations, this is the equation of SHM and this is the equation of that mass which I obtained just now. So I will find here that this k by m, and this it is a term omega n square, so this will be the value of omega n square. So I can write omega n square is equal to k by m, and therefore omega n is equal to under root of k by m, where this omega n is nothing but called like the circular natural frequency in radian per second. And now if I do find out the natural frequency, that is indicated by fn, will be equal to omega n by 2 pi. So it will be 1 upon 2 pi in under root k by m, that is in terms of hertz. So also we know that this mg is equal to k into delta, we have obtained from the first in the first equation. So here I can write k by m is equal to nothing but g by delta. This is delta here. Okay, so I can put the value of k by m as d g by delta also. So I can have the equation of frequency, natural frequency, as 1 upon 2 pi in under root g by delta hertz, or 1 upon 2 pi in under root k by m. Both these equations are useful to us for finding out the natural frequency. Next we will see how we can obtain the natural frequency by using the energy method. So the law of conservation of energy states that the total energy of the system remains constant. It means in this case the kinetic energy and the potential energy of the system will be constant at a particular time. So if I differentiate the sum of kinetic energy and potential energy with respect to time, that definitely the derivative will be equal to zero, as this particular energy is constant. So the derivative of constant is equal to zero. Now let us try to determine for a spring mass system again what is the kinetic energy and what is the potential energy. So the kinetic energy is generally by 1/2 mv square. So kinetic energy is equal to 1/2, m is nothing but the mass of that particular block, and v is nothing but x dot its square. And potential energy, if I do find out, it is nothing but the area under the force and displacement diagram. So here you can see that force displacement diagram. So as the force is applied, the spring will go on displacing from its initial position. So we can find out the potential energy of this particular triangle, that is equal to 1/2 base into height. So it is nothing but a triangle. So 1/2 base into height is the area of this particular triangle. So base is x and height is f. So 1 by 2 f into x. So 1 by 2. Now f is nothing but the force. Now that force is having stiffness and the displacement, these two terms. So we are going to put the force as k into x. Okay, so it becomes 1 by 2 k x square. Now once I got these two terms, that is potential energy and the kinetic energy, so I will make the sum of these two and I will try to differentiate this with respect to time. So here I have written the kinetic energy 1/2 mv square plus 1 by 2 kx square, that is equal to 0. So when I am differentiating this with respect to time, so this is 1 by 2 as a constant, so m is also a constant, so x dot square, it becomes 2 into x dot, and again derivative of this x dot, that is nothing but equal to x double dot, plus 1 by 2 and k, that is constant, so 1 by 2 k will be there. So derivative of x square is the equal to 2x and multiplied by this derivative of x with respect to time t, so it will be x dot. Now definitely here 2 will get cancelled out in both left here and this side also. Then what is remaining is, so it will be m into x double dot plus k into x, and this x dot here and this x dot here is to be taken common. Okay, and this common, if I move it towards right side, so it, as it is multiplied with the 0, so final equation remains will be mx double dot plus kx equal to 0. Now here also we have to compare this equation with the equation of simple harmonic motion. So this is the fundamental equation of x double dot plus omega n square into x is the fundamental equation of simple harmonic motion. So if I compare this equation with this, I will find out that this k by m, again here the term which is the coefficient of x, so this is nothing but omega n square. So that is omega n square is equal to k by m, and therefore omega n is equal to under root of k by m, that is in radian per second. And frequency if in hertz I require, so it will be 1 upon 2 pi under root k by m. Okay, so after this now we will see the Rayleigh's method. So this is according to the principle of conservation of energy. We know that the total energy remains constant. So total energy at the mean position will be equal to the total energy at the extreme position. So this is the equation given by the Rayleigh's. So according to his method, if you find out the total energy at the mean position, that must be equal to the total energy at the extreme position. So we know that this is the mass and this is the mean position of it. So whatever the total energy will be here, that you have to find out, and the total energy at the extreme position, it means over here you have to find out. Okay, so when it is here, I will say this as the one position and this is the position two, as it is specified here. One is the mean position and two is the extreme position. So kinetic energy plus potential energy at point one over here, first I have to find out, and then kinetic energy at point two I have to find out. So as I'm writing here, so kinetic energy plus potential energy at one equal to kinetic energy plus potential energy at two. So these two energies will be equal. So here actually there is no potential energy because it is at the mean position. So potential energy will be zero here in this case at position one, while the block will completely stop here. So velocity will be zero here, displacement will be zero at this point, and therefore there is no kinetic energy over here. So at point two, kinetic energy will be equal to zero. It means whatever the kinetic energy is there at point one, it will be your maximum kinetic energy, and whatever the potential energy we have at the point two will be your maximum potential energy. And this you are equating, so with by equating this we can get the value of the natural frequency of the system. Okay, so now we will see how we can do that. So by Rayleigh's, the maximum kinetic energy which is at the mean position is equal to the maximum potential energy which is at the extreme position. Okay, so now we know that the displacement at any time t is given by capital X into sine of omega n t, and therefore x dot means velocity will be is equal to omega n into x into cos of omega n t. So at mean means at time t equal to 0, x dot will be maximum, means velocity will be maximum, and that maximum velocity will be equal to omega into x, because if I put the value of t equal to 0 here, cos 0 becomes 1, and therefore maximum value of the velocity is omega n into x. Now kinetic energy I will find out by using the displacement and velocity. So kinetic energy needs a velocity, that is x dot max. So I will write 1 half m into x dot max bracket square, that is equal to 1 half m omega n square into capital X square. Similarly, now I will find out the potential energy at the extreme position. So potential energy will be equal to 1 half k x square at the extreme position, that is at x equal to capital X. So if I put the value of x equal to capital X, then you will get the value of potential energy, which is a maximum. So this potential energy I will write 1 by 2 k into x square at extreme position. So just have to put the value of x as a capital X, that is I will get P max. Now you have to put this equation B in equation 1. So here in this equation, actually I should specify this equation, okay, as 1 here. So I am putting this K max is equal to P max. So I will go for this, equating these two. So 1 half m into omega n square capital X square is equal to 1 by 2 k into capital X square. This is my kinetic energy I calculated, maximum kinetic energy, and this is my maximum potential energy calculated. So from here we can see that this is 1 by 2, 1 by 2 get cancelled out, and x square get cancelled out. What is remaining is this m into omega n square, and this is equal to k. So if I put this m towards right side, it will go in the denominator. So omega n square is equal to k by m, and therefore omega n is equal to under root of k by m. So this is the way you can find out the natural frequency by Rayleigh's method. So in the next class we will see about the undamped free vibrations, and we will see the natural frequency for longitudinal, transverse and torsional vibrating system. Thank you.